Gregor Mendel's experiments laid the foundation of modern-day genetics. We have seen so far that Mendel crossed a purple-flowered plant with a white-flowered plant. He then collected the seeds and grew new plants from them. Astonishingly, he found that all the offsprings had purple-colored flowers. Now, on crossing these plants among themselves, Mendel surprisingly obtained 3 purple-flowered plants and 1 white-flowered plant. How could this be possible? Moreover, what could be the probable reasons for this? The first set of results were that all the plants in the first, or F1 generation, were with purple-colored flowers. Here, the term F1 indicates the first filial generation. In this case, he considered color of the flower as a character. Did he cross pea plants having other characters too? Yes, he considered all the other characters like plant height, seed color, and so on. And then he found that only one character is expressed in the F1 generation. For instance, he crossed a pea plant having round seeds with the one having wrinkled seeds. In the F1 generation, he obtained all the plants having only round seeds. It implied that the offsprings are similar to only one of the parents and do not have any resemblance with the other. And this was seen for all the characters. Now, getting back to our example of flower color, Mendel obtained all the plants with purple-colored flowers in the F1 generation. But this wasn't the case in the next step. When the offsprings from this F1 generation were crossed, one plant out of the 4 had traits just like the original parent that was considered. That means in this case, 1 out of the 4 had white-colored flowers and 3 had purple-colored flowers. With this, he concluded that characters are passed from one generation to the other. With the current knowledge we have, we know that this is due to the passing of genes. However, it was not known back then. Mendel named these as factors. So it was believed that there are factors which carry these traits from one generation to the other. But what about the disappearance of the trait in one complete generation? In the F1 generation, the trait of white-colored flowers was not seen at all. This was explained by Mendel in a very efficient manner. He explained that in organisms like the green peas, one factor is always expressed and it superpowers the presence of the other factor. We call these factors as genes or alleles now. We will have a detailed look at what genes mean in our upcoming parts. But for now, let's focus on Mendel's work. In today's terms, Mendel said that some genes are always expressed irrespective of the other. These are called dominant genes. The others which are suppressed are referred to as recessive genes. So why did the recessive genes not express themselves in the F1 generation? And how did they get expressed in the F2 generation? Let's understand this with the help of a theoretical explanation of this cross. Let's consider letter P written in uppercase as the allele, that is factor in Mendel's terms, for the purple-colored flower. And the white-colored flower will be represented with the allele P written in lowercase. Now, the first cross included purple-flowered plant and a white-flowered plant. So this is how we can represent this crossing. Any idea why have we used the letter P twice here? It's simple. The green pea plant is a diploid plant. What does diploid mean? We have always come across the saying that humans have 23 pairs of chromosomes. That's because the chromosomes in us are always in pairs. Each set has one chromosome from each parent. This is nothing but the diploid nature. So when organisms have 2 sets of chromosomes, they are referred to as diploid organisms. Getting back to green peas, there are 2 sets of genes in it. That is why we use the letter twice to represent both the allelic forms. So here, PP written in uppercase will represent the purple color of flowers, while PP written in lowercase will represent the white color of flowers. Now in this cross, the gametes, which are nothing but the reproductive cells, will be formed like this, and the cross will yield us this result. How? This combination, this one, then this one, and this is the last one. These are the four possible combinations. Now, as you can see here, PP indicates that the offspring has one dominant and one recessive allele. In such a case, the plants will have only purple flowers, as the presence of one dominant gene is enough to express the trait. That is why all the plants have purple-colored flowers in the F1 generation. Now, can you guess why the ratio 3:1 is obtained in the F2 generation? Let's find that out with the help of a similar theoretical cross. Here, we take any two random plants from the F1 generation. Crossing these two, or even by carrying out the selfing process in a similar fashion, gives us this result. Now, as we can see here, these three offsprings have at least one dominant gene. That is the reason why each of these is a purple-flowered plant. Now, in this case, both the genes are recessive. That means no gene to dominate the trait. As a result, the plant expresses the recessive trait, that is, white-colored flowers. This was the simplest way to explain Mendel's results. Dominant genes are those which are expressed in both homozygous and heterozygous forms. On the other hand, recessive genes are those which can be expressed only when present in homozygous form. Hold on. Any idea what do we mean by homozygous and heterozygous? We know that the term homo means same and hetero means different. So homozygous means the set of genes are same, both either dominant or both recessive. For example, PP and PP are both homozygous forms. Heterozygous is exactly opposite of this. It simply means both the forms are different. So here, PP represents the heterozygous form, one dominant, one recessive. So, the dominant alleles are expressed in both homozygous and heterozygous forms, while recessive alleles can be expressed when present only in the homozygous forms. This was just an introduction to Mendel's experiments. Let's have a look at one more example and a few more terms in genetics in the next part. We have seen how the cross of a character, like flower color, is carried out. In this part, let's get introduced to a few more interesting terms in genetics. But before that, let's understand the cross of one more character and get thorough with it. Before beginning any such experiment, we need to make sure that the parents selected are homozygous in nature. So let's say we wish to cross two organisms with some trait named A. The dominant form should ideally be AA both in uppercase, while the recessive form has to be AA both in lowercase. Now, the recessive form will definitely be homozygous. Why? Yes, we know that the recessive character is expressed only when it's in the homozygous form. But the dominant character can have both the sets of alleles. So AA in uppercase as well as AA, one in upper and the other in lowercase, can give us a dominant case. So it could be homozygous or heterozygous. Now, how are we supposed to know whether the organism considered for crossing is homozygous or heterozygous for a particular character? For this, we have the concept of pure lines. Pure lines are nothing but the descendants obtained after inbreeding for several generations. Confused? Don't be. It's easy to understand this with an example.
Let's say we have this particular breed of dogs. Both these have genes for a good coat on their skin, say C. So, both these dogs may have the genes CC, both in uppercase, or CC, that is, one in upper and the other in lowercase. On crossing these two dogs, we get these offsprings. Clearly, the genes are passed to this generation. Now, on crossing any of the two dogs from this same progeny, we get these offsprings. That means again, the same set of genes is passed to the next generation. Imagine this is done for a few more generations. What will be the result? The progeny at the end will have these genes conserved. But notice something interesting. As we keep crossing the individuals in the same family, the chances of obtaining the homozygous form is enhanced. This process of crossing individuals from the same family is called inbreeding. And offsprings obtained after inbreeding several generations are called pure lines. One of the advantages of using pure lines while beginning the experiment is to have an assurance that the organism is homozygous even for the dominant trait. Now, let's focus back on the cross we were about to carry out. This time, let's consider the character stem height in the pea plant. Here, we take a tall and a dwarf plant. Both these are pure lines. On crossing the parental generation, we get these offsprings in the F1 generation. Now, what will happen when we cross these two plants from the F1 generation? It will give us these results. Take a moment to go through this. So what we get is three tall plants and one dwarf plant. Isn't this the same ratio that Mendel obtained when flower color was considered as the character? Yes, it is. He had obtained three purple and one white flower in the F2 generation. Similarly, here we get three tall and one dwarf plant. Now that we've had a good idea about crossing, let me introduce two new terms to you. Trust me, they are very simple to understand. The two terms are phenotypic ratio and genotypic ratio. In this case, the phenotypic ratio is 3:1, that is, three tall plants and one dwarf plant. And the genotypic ratio is 1:2:1. As we can see, one plant is homozygous for the tall trait, these two are heterozygous, and this one is homozygous for the recessive trait dwarf. Any idea what these terms mean? Let's understand them first and then proceed with understanding the ratios. The features that can be seen or observed by us externally are called phenotypes. Pheno is a prefix that indicates an observable characteristic. We could clearly see in this case, three are tall and one is a dwarf plant. Hence, the phenotypic ratio is 3:1. What about the genotypic ratio? Let's take an example here. If we look at this tall guy, what can we say about his genes? This tall guy can have the genes TT both in uppercase or TT one in upper and the other in lowercase. We can't really predict it. So just by having a glance, we can't really guess if the individual is homozygous or heterozygous for height as the character. So the features of the genetic level which cannot be observed are called genotypes. In simple words, the physical expression of the genes giving rise to the particular observable traits can be termed as phenotype. On the other hand, genotype can be defined as the set of genes that give rise to a particular trait. That is the genetic makeup of an organism. So, the trait that's visible to us is the phenotype, and what genes the organism has for that trait is the genotype. For example, if this boy has black eyes, then the eye color seen by us is the boy's phenotype, and the genes that he has inherited from his parents, which are not seen by us, are a part of his genotype. Now getting back to our experiment. How do we understand the genotypic ratio? Well, as we can see, we have one homozygous tall plant, two heterozygous tall plants, and one homozygous dwarf plant. So, the genotypic ratio is 1 to 2 to 1. Now, we are all well versed with the crosses and also a few important terms in genetics. Take a moment to go through these important terms once. Let's now move ahead and understand Gregor Mendel's experiments further. So far, we've seen how Mendel crossed plants and studied one character at a time. Do you think he always crossed only a single character at a time? No. After he completed crossing all the characters individually, he crossed two characters at a time, followed by three, and so on. The cross involving one character at a time is called monohybrid cross. So whatever we've learned so far was a monohybrid cross. And the ratio obtained after the cross is nothing but a monohybrid ratio. How is a dihybrid cross, that is a cross involving two characters at a time, carried out then? And what about the dihybrid ratio? Let's get to know that in the next part.